Alrighty, here goes the presentation. Hopefully the audio works out. So I'm just going to quickly go over the PDF I sent had 3 pages. Just ignore the last one. I'm just going to be talking about these 2 pages. In the chat I had mentioned that to try matching one of these 4 patterns to the images on the right. So as for my quick video demonstration, I'm just gonna pick this one here, number 2. Hopefully you can see my cursor. Basically this 4-value system was sort of imported from Europe, from the old masters, and a guy called Howard Pyle, an artist called Howard Pyle in the United States, sort of championed this as an organizational paradigm. And the basic statement is that any image that you, any 2-dimensional image like a photograph or painting or drawing fits into one of these 4 patterns. Most of the time when you look at a photograph or real life, there's like a million different shades of value. And that tends to throw students off, or people learning how to do drawing and painting. It tends to throw them off because there's just too much to cope with. So the idea is that to get a strong image with a lot of pop and to reduce the confusion, you reduce the picture plane to one of these 4 patterns or 4 values. You can think of them as buckets because they don't have to be one. They're more or less precise. In the beginning, when you're laying out the image, you want you want to be as precise as possible. So if you look at the bottom here, I've got a scale. Typically, artists use a scale from 1 to 9. Now I've done value scales using pencil, and I've done 33 different gradations, but the finer you get, the harder it gets to tell between any 2 points. You can go up to 100 different gradations, and maybe more in oil paint, but especially when you add color, you get different ranges of value within the pigment, so it can multiply out. But basically, when you're dealing with black and white, it's best to simplify things and use a scale from 1 to 9. So I set these 4 values to be number one. So number 1 is the lightest, and number 9 is the darkest. Notice that number 9 is not absolute black. Technically, number 1 should not be absolute white. I don't know if I have that it set, but anyway, we're just gonna leave it the way it is. So my light is number 1. So that would be this. Okay. My second dark would be number 3. So that's this color here. You'll see it in different places in the organizational paradigm of each pattern. Number 7 is this one here. I'm just pointing to them with the screen, and number 9 is that there. Okay. So I'm going to explain quickly why these map to each one. So number 1 maps to this lady and the child up on the hillside. The basic way to figure out which pattern fits with which image is, don't look at the foreground. Look at the background, because the background determines the dominant value for the scheme. And so number one is dominantly white, is dominantly light. The vast majority of the area on the surface is light. So that's your key, so it's a bright, high value setting. If you look in this area here on the girl, you've got black. So you've got the number nine value in there, and you've got the there. You can see the lighter parts of her hair there are this darker value. Essentially, if you look here and here, you have a similar situation, and in down in anywhere, like over here and over here. Basically, if you look at the pattern, the darks corral a light. Now in pattern number one, the darks are, it's got two sets. It's got the light corralling or surrounding the darks, and then inset in the dark is that darker light. So basically, the whole idea of this whole pattern structure is that you're surrounding darks with lights or lights surrounded by darks. So that's that pattern matches to this one. The second one, that one's pretty obvious. The dominant, almost any interior is going to, well, it depends on how, if you have interior light, then it won't be true. But this is a sort of a, for the most part, if you don't have the lights on inside, here the light's spilling in through into the room. So you, there's the window right there. And then the vast majority of the room is dark shadow. And then all the objects in the room are the lighter dark and the darker light. You have to kind of think in these terms, because you've got two lights, one lighter and one darker, and you've got two darks, one lighter and one darker. So that's that. So that's why that one's number four. Number three is this one. And that's because it's outside, but it's under dappled shade. So you're going to have some punchy darks, which is this square here. And the it's a bit confusing because if you try and look for this tone, you're not really going to see it. But what you have to think is if you take the darks and this as a mid-tone, like underneath the bush here, there's plenty of spaces. It's just laced throughout the image. Those two sum to the overall average of being this light or dark in the background. And then you've got speckled or dappled light in which you've got some less, the sun coming through, and you've got the lighter light and the darker light, like in here, in some of the flowers on the side of the house, kind of thing. So that gives you number three. And then finally, what was the last one that we needed to do? So we did this. Oh, this one's the last one that we need to do. So that's number two. And again, same concept as number three, some average. You can see a lot more of that second, that darker light. But there is white, but it kind of squint your eyes, and if you squint your eyes and you look, you'll see that the combination of the light and the lighter light and the darker light sum to a large area of that darker light. And if you squint your eyes and you look at this image over here, the fourth image, the lady and the girl, you'll find that it sums to more of a brighter volume, and that gives you the setting. So if you look at so the background matches to behind the sleds, and then you've got, so you've got that light here surrounded by a dark and supported by the lighter dark. And same within this figure, and same with this in this figure. Now this figure, these two figures are capturing light. This figure is a silhouette. So you've basically got these two values, but in the negative space between, you've got light popping through. So you can see how the whole organizational paradigm works. So basically, when you decide to work your image, and this also accelerates your ability to get it done, because as I'm going to show you, because I don't have much time before we actually have to go, meet you guys online. Basically, I'm going to show you how fast you can work if you just think in general terms. So I'm going to work on this one with the sled here, and I'm just going to work on a pad there. I'll just go into my other program, and let me see if I can zoom in to the one that we're doing. Okay, and I'm just going to put it like that, and we'll move that over. Sorry, we've got somebody watching me, that painting in the background. Now that's where I did it in color, and I was reducing it to the four value pattern. But anyway, so I'm just going to do a quick demonstration of how to do this and how I work. What I'm doing here is this is from Neutrum, it's a sanding pad, and I've got a charcoal from Neutrum. It's actually a Canadian company. It used to be French, but I won't go into the history of that. It allows you to shape your charcoal. It's well worth getting one of these paddles, and they come with replacement sand that you can take this off. It's Velcro, and you can put a new one on. So it's highly useful if you get into. The other tools that I am using are two brushes. I'll talk about the brushes, two different sizes. This one's more for detail. This is just bigger swipes. And if I was working on a large composition, I might even have a larger one, but I'm a disorganized person, and this is what I got going this morning because I couldn't find my charcoal stuff. I use one of these gum erasers from Generals. It's like an orange color. The reason is that once you get a certain amount on, it's hard to remove. But if you're going to get it back to white, this is going to get you there. But there's also a lesson about contextualization. So even if you can't get it perfectly back to white, you never actually want in an artwork to have pure white on like the white of the paper. If you want to have a properly harmonized picture. This is a soft gummy eraser. It allows you to shape it, and you can do some shaping. Sometimes I use a more precise rate vinyl eraser. I did find another brush. I was going to try this. It's from Faber-Castell. I wouldn't use this. This is an eraser pencil, but these are useless. But this might work for coarse brushing. I have two stubbies for blending. I'm not really going to get into blending. I'm just going to show you how fast you can get this stuff done and how to work. The charcoal that I'm using is from a pack here. You can look Neutrum. You can find them online, or there's a number of stores. I think in Toronto, Above Ground carries them. These are 12 millimeter, that's the diameter, and they're soft. So for doing a quick charcoal sketch, that works perfectly. So I'm just going to take a quick drink of my coffee. And lastly, right at the beginning, I use a paper towel as a sort of a broad kind of wiping and smudging if I need it. I try to avoid, well, we'll see how it goes. I've mostly been work, it's been a while since I've done charcoal. So I'll just go into mode here. So basically when I start, I'm gonna do the whole sheet here. So when I start, I think of it in terms of quadrants, like if I'm moving fast on a composition. Now, I do a whole, I'm going to be doing a whole series on accurate measurement, and I'll be doing that on I don't know whether I'm doing it on YouTube or Twitch or something. I'm going to have to figure that out. But all about using cross-referencing to do highly precise measurements. But in today's demonstration, we're not doing that. I'm just trying to give you, there are kind of two ways of thinking, very precisely and very generally. So today is, I'm going to be showing you the very general way of thinking. And so I'm going to work in quadrants. So I don't normally put the lines down to say this quadrant and that quadrant. I just project it in my head, like the halfway points, and say, okay. And then I work around in a clock. Now the reason that in a clockwise motion, the reason that I do this, yeah, and you can reverse clockwise, but the reason I do this is because you don't want to work in any one area too long. Like if I work all the detail in this area, that may look great, but then I have to balance all these areas. You want to, Rembrandt was able to finish his, stop drawing at it kind of in any point, and just because of the way he worked it, because he worked it like this, it had a sense of completion. So I'm going to work quickly and just kind of sketch in some broad tones here, and then move to the second panel, or here, and go around like that. I sometimes go like this. It depends on how you feel. So anyway, I'm going to start doing that right now, because I am running out of time. So here we go. So basically, the first thing, what I do to begin with, like I'm still thinking in four buckets, but in the first go around, rather than think, okay, which of the four values am I doing? I basically think in terms of two values. And the lighter light and the darker light, I just categorize as the lighter light. And in this case today, I'm just gonna leave it white. And usually when I start by knocking in the darks. And when I lay it in, I don't do the darkest dark, which I call dark number two. I do the lighter dark, because then that gives me room to push down into the dark. Also, if you want to change, and sometimes I even do the darker light, just to make sure I've got the drawing light right, because when you're working with charcoal, depending on the paper that you're using, it can be, if you start nailing in really hard darks, it's hard to lift off and erase if you want to make an adjustment or change. So I'm going to come in fairly light. So the nice thing about putting quadrants is if I look in that upper left-hand corner, I'm just going to use the mouse here for a second. If you think about the halfway point being here, it's kind of where the boy's head is. So I'm just going to actually just sort of put an indication of that's where his head is, just to remind me. So when I'm looking at this and I'm looking at the image, I can go, oh yeah, that's the halfway point. Now, if I didn't put the horizontal and vertical, that would be kind of a marker to me to where the halfway point is. I always try and find something that's on a halfway point. So if you look on the vertical here, the child in the foreground, his head is just to the left of the to the vertical. So anyway, I'm going to work I'm just gonna lay in quickly. Now the boy comes in here. If I go up from the head, so with my eyes I'm looking. Here I've got the pointer, so I there's not much dark here, and then the tree sort of veers off there. It's very easy to see the smaller part rather than consider the whole part. So it actually helps you get. I'm not like that might not be 100% right. I'm just throwing darks in where they need to be, more or less. And I've got that to give myself an overall picture. And then I don't want to spend too much time. So if you look at that halfway point, you can see that it really goes to the halfway through his thigh. So I am going to just roughly just on that part sort of nail, just indicate kind of where the foreground head is. So that says to me that I've got to get my, the boy, the face kind of in there, and then this over here. And then the dark, there's a dark coming down the side there, and the arm fits in there with a bit of space, and there's a little bit on the other side to give the arm definition. And then now I'm going to talk about shapes in a second. And then his pants come across, so you're thinking of that head the whole time. Now I kind of went a little bit too high on that head in the foreground, so I'm going to just pop that down a little bit. And because I didn't go too dark, I can easily move that, and this will get swallowed in the overall volume of tones. So I'm pulling the dark down, and then I'm getting the side of the leg. And the side of the leg kind of joins into the top of the head down here. And then I'm going to pull it across, and then I'm going to drop the dark down on the other side. And I'm just going to quickly just do a little bit of evening out on the tones, just to give it a nice solid look. And at that, if I look, the head is a lot higher. Okay, and so I want to show you a little bit how you can see where to make the corrections. And you can see that if I look at that quadrant, this comes down here. And a large part of the light side of his body is on that side. So I kind of screwed up there a little bit like that. And his head is surrounded, but it's always good making mistakes, because when I'm doing this, because it shows you how to kind of correct. But if you notice, what's happening here is there's a dark back here, and it's surrounding the top part of his body here. So I need to have that in my drawing. That can maybe go a little bit higher. And then that means that this is more or less dark back there. And then this is quite dark to down there. And this, I was looking at it being a third, but if I pull this across, if I pull a line across there, really the distance there this is almost 3/4 or more than 3/4 of the way down this little quadrant over here, if you think of the quadrant like that, right? So that, I was guessing it at a third, but I was obviously not paying attention. And so there you go. And you can start to see the figure emerge. Now that's enough. I've done, now I'm looking at the video and it's not coming across that dark. But again, as I said, if I want to change anything, I don't want to go too dark. So now I'm going to move to the next quadrant. Okay. So as I'm looking at it, I'm thinking about how this interjects into the back quadrant, and it interjects at about the halfway point. If you think, now we're working in this quadrant right here. Okay, so that's about halfway. So if you think about that, I'm going to leave the pointer there. If you think about that, then then the majority of the top part up here is going to be in like is going to be in shadow with a break for the snowy branch there, and so by working this way you can kind of see you can kind of see how easy it is to draw without doing all this like fancy measurement you can do. And then my light or dark, I'm just going to do a wisp of a tone there for the snow that's in shadow back there. Okay, is going to be in there. And you'll see how this image just pops out pretty fast. And then this comes down a little bit. And then if I look at the hand, how far the hand, here's there, there's a gap that comes to about there. And then I pull a diagonal up and I've got the little boy's head here. And if I look across here, his head is above the head that's right here. And then you've got a shadow. And then if I look at that quadrant, he's about halfway in the quadrant. Another time I'll talk about intervals and their relations. It's a lot like music. So here I'm going to just throw the dark on that side, okay? And then a little bit of shadow for the snow and maybe a little bit over here. The neat thing about this is it really gets you to the old master kind of feel right away because of this simplification. There is a version of this with three values, but I find the four values is more instructive and easier to manage. So now I've done this about as much as I've done that, so it's time to move on. So I'm going to move down here and I'm going to analyze. And if you look, then basically you can see that the majority of this figure falls across into this lower quadrant, and you can see that it the sleigh kind of comes out. So it's in a way it's a very quick way to get the measurement. And then the this is a bit too low. Normally I like having my head like looking right here, so everything's equidistant, but right now my eye level is in here, so looking down. I don't like that because it can throw off your perspective, but I'm going to quickly map in. I'm going to switch hands and just out with it. It's been a while since I used to, when I was younger, I worked a lot on being ambidextrous, and I can, if I practice a bit, I can grab it back. But there's the light tone, and then I'm just going to come back in and reinforce this dark. Think about how that jacket or coat is going to maybe sit there. And then just thinking a little bit more about the shape, it triangulates up there. Not sure what's happening. He might be joining in, but we'll get into that in a second. Okay, I'm going to pull that across. And then if you look right across here, this is where the bottom of the sleigh works, and see it's all working proportion out. Now, what I was going to talk like is all working out proportionally. What I was going to talk, and you can see the image starting to form very quickly. The other thing that I was going to say is that while you're in this stage, it's and the other stages, you I used to, when I was teaching, come up with silly sayings. And one of my silly sayings was connecty darks and connecty lights. So while you're doing this, I'm laying in the darks and I'm laying in the lights. I want to connect darks together and sometimes even force a connection between them. But connect the darks together and connect the lights together, because that helps give it a sort of a binding unification. In certain instances, you can distinguish it a little bit more, but it helps the eye follow around, because your eye follows the general lights and the general darks. And design wise, you want to have that flow of these connected darks and connected lights in order to move the eye around. I'm back in here. So if you look, you can see that the body of this small child, now if you look, his I don't know what the hell that is. It's not even, I'm not sure what that is. It looks like it could be, it's a light shape that's inside his body there. So I'm leaving a patch there, and then the arm is over here, and then he's got something bundled up on his sled there. And then there's the second dark that joins there. And then this drops down to the same level as this arm over here on the body. And then the shadow of the sled is underneath, and that connects down. And then there's a crossbar. And then if I take a vertical up from here, you'll see that that kind of lands at where the dark is. So maybe I've got to move that back a little bit, and I've got to pull the dark there. In which case, I'm going to come in with my eraser, and I'm just going to move that back like that. So you can make minor correct. This is great for making minor corrections as long as you're not nailing the darks in. I'm just going to take a quick look at the time. Yep, 32. So I still have to do this video. So compile this video. Oh, what happened there? I lost my window capture. Oops. Hang on, Alt Tab. Okay, sorry about this. Give me it. Cancel. Save. Nope. What on earth? Hang on. Sorry about this. Oh, I opened up. I'm working on a Cezanne. So hang on one second. Let me switch to Designer. There we go. Sorry about that. Anyway. So I'm just gonna keep moving quadrants. And I'm just gonna more evenly do this shadow down here on the snow. You kind of don't want to get that, but that's why you want to have things up and to give yourself room not to bump into things. But I'm just improvising this on the fly. Okay, so here's our so back to our sled. This comes in here and he connects down, and you can see that maybe this whole thing is a little bit further over. And then he's somehow like that. Now, I would think about how far is this between here and there, but I'm not going to go to that level of detail right now. Okay, so now I'm into the last quadrant. As I do the last quadrant, I can see that the dark extends right down to the bottom of the picture plane, and I can mask that in. And right now we're just on two values, and I think I'm going to have to just leave the video at two values. It depends on whether I can get this kind of demonstration thing happening on Messenger, but I doubt I can. So the arm comes across a lot more. So that's scaling up, like the more this has to be over there and the more this has to be over there, that's making the figure bigger in the foreground. Now I'm just going to map. There is a, if you look, there's a lighter dark here, but I'm going to kind of treat that, seeing as I'm drawing in with this dark and not that dark because I want to be able to erase a bit. I'm just going to treat this whole thing like that. And then when I go for the second go around, I can push this down, and I can push down that, and I can leave that. And then this tuft of grass or vegetation that's left over from the spring,
that's going to be in here, and then this second tone comes in here. I'm just going to push this a little bit darker so that when I put the and I'm going to get irritated with this, so I'm going to pull that up and just map that tone in and connect it to the other one on the other side. I'm going to move that up. Sorry about this. Okay, and then let's finally let's see if we can connect that leg down. And you can see that the fold in the leg is opposite the bottom of the head here, and then that foot plants down, and then there's a connecting shadow. So see how I'm joining, this is maybe a little bit more curved. See how I'm joining that shadow together, and then pulling that shadow up, and that kind of gives me the width. And again, I can play the same trick with this. Because I'm mapping in with this tone, just treat this all as one shape. And then as I'm looking at it, I can try and get the drawing better on that, oh, that whole shape. So I'm gonna pop the head. I'm even gonna connect the head to the leg there, but you can see that it looks like elephantitis or whatever. But because I'm gonna be coming in darker, you'll see that when I go in darker, the head will pop back out again. So I'm just gonna come in like this, get the side of the body. There's an angle change, connects up to here, and then this kind of light goes up to his shoulder. So maybe get that a bit better. And then the dark comes over and drops down. And then you've got his head, his face is framed in that area right there and comes down like that. And if you look, you can see the, oops, let me get this in a little bit better. And the back of the sledge. So I missed a little bit there. And then this shadow coming across. And where is that shadow? That shadow is at where the turn of the leg is. So that would be in and around there. And then I've got a secondary, I've got the, that would be the, probably the darker, that's the darker light. On the snow, you want to use a light dark. Okay, so there you go. And then I want to think, I'm just going to quickly reinforce this dark. So on the second go around, you want to start popping in, you want to start putting in, I did put the shadow on the snow, but I kind of treated it all as one. But on the second go around, we're going to, let me just see how much time I have. We're going to start punching down to the darker dark, so that you can start to see this light again. So I'm coming around like that. This comes over there. That connects in. I want to leave a bit of a gap, so that'll be the lighter dark. I don't want it to be too bright. Oh, and I forgot the dark in here, so I'm going to pull that in. And then his arm is in shadow like that. And then see how there's a little, you get a little wisp of an idea of separation here. Okay, that's why I say it's buckets. They're basically the same tone, so but slightly differentiated. So I'm going to join that whole thing together to make the leg. Okay, and then leave that light to pop out. And then just as he did, this is a drawing by Andrew Loomis, by the way. So I'm going to, just while I'm here, draw down the dark side and leave that light on the leg there, and so on and so forth. So I'm going to pull the darker light across here now, and I can get pretty scribbly in here and just kind of feel around where things are. And the one thing to note about what I'm doing here is just kind of feeling, I'm getting this the sense of those gnarled branches without much effort. And the greatest art is really loose, yet tight at the same time. So see how easy it is for me to get that branch, and I'm paying a little bit more attention on this go around. Okay, so that's connecting into there, and then that connects into that dark. And I'm basically going to look at this kind of abstract shape, which kind of gives the bush. And as you're doing this, you see now we've got a tree and a bush there, and then we've got a shard of a dark. I'm going to maybe drift this lighter tone across like that, and then push that down, and then there's a bit of snow creeping up the tree there. So it's kind of drawing by amorphous blob. So the tree's kind of coming over here, and then that connects in here, and to give the sort of the motion of the snow, that's what he does. And then I'm going to come in and I'm going to knock down the dark, and you can see everything sort of building. I'm not going to be too precise here because I want to go as fast as possible because I got to get this up. Okay, and then I can throw in, I'd like to throw it in more like that, so I'll have to be a bit more careful. But anyway, you can begin to see the image forming very quickly, and of course you get more and more refined as you go along. I'm not really following that, but I pushed down a little bit more, got a little bit more definition. I'm just pushing the darks in, then I'll and just making sure that I keep moving on and don't stay in one place. I don't always follow the clock. At the first time round, I followed the clockwise. Sometimes the second time around, but then I just, as I see things connecting, you know, how do I need to connect this darker dark to all these other darks, I start just following the flow of the pattern. See that comes in and inserts in here, right? So and then it angles off like that, and then we've got that lighter dark, or the darker is actually the second, it's the darker light that comes in, and then the bottom of his glove. Okay, I'm gonna keep going, and then I think I might have to stop, but I think this gives you enough of an idea as to what's happening. I'm just gonna pop that. See this little light here. Okay, that's probably the lighter dark, like that and like that one. But that, it's connected through here, but that little break just says this is in the foreground and that's in the background, and this is a head and that's a leg. So here's the gap. So I'm going to come in, and then if I let it run down a little bit, and then I just pop in that head, and then come across and down like that. I might have a, anyway, that's going to come up maybe a bit. There's different ways. Sometimes you think you've drawn something too small, but you're only off by an eighth or a quarter of an inch. It's always that kind of thing. So here, to get the collar on the jacket, just coming back through and punching the darks down. And then I can kind of think about this negative shape. It's a lot smaller. And then how does that negative shape work? That's probably a term that negative shape is just the in-between bits. The positive shape are the objects that are in the field. So there we go. I'm coming along. And already you can see
I could, if I was doing a painting, I might choose to just diminish this and then just focus in on here, and then basically you're getting the look between these two figures, right? And that's slightly darker down here. So see how that kind of runs you around and gives you, you start lassoing shapes. You're lassoing lights and you're lassoing darks. But that should be enough to give you a gist. Oh, I want to get a little bit on the side of the face there. And it gives you something to play around with and try. And I will take it a lot further at another point. For right now, I think I have to try and get this up. I didn't use any of these things, so that was useless. But anyway, I'm going to call it quits, and I'm going to try and upload this video, and hopefully it works. Anyway, thanks for bearing with me. Bye.